I'm talking to Frank Zappa, who's over here in London now. I want to ask you first, Frank, because I haven't seen you for 20 years, about the children who are now grown up. And when I last saw them, they were tiny tots. In fact, two of them weren't even born.
Moon, that's really a tiny tot.
That's right.
That's a micro tot.
That's right. Moon is what? She's about 20 now, is she? Yeah. She was 4 years old when I last saw her. And what is she doing now?
Well, she has a boyfriend and she has her own house, and she and Dweezil have a deal with CBS television to do a pilot for a sitcom for the fall. So that's what she's working on.
So she's working in television?
And right. Being an actress.
And when did she move out, as it were?
Early this year.
So you have three of them living with you now?
Well, she's over at the house quite a bit anyway, even though she has her own place, but... Yeah, three of them are still there. We hardly see Dweezil because he has his own career and he's wandering around promoting his new album. In fact, he's here in London right now doing some work for MTV. And Amit, who I don't think you've even seen.
No, I didn't know him, but what is he, 15 now?
He's 13.
13, right.
And Diva is 8. Amit is, let's be kind and describe him as a sex-crazed lunatic. And
after father, he follow up with father, does he?
Yes, he does. And I'm sure that Diva will eventually follow in her big brother's footsteps. She's very peculiar. I think she's psychic. We have a fax machine at the house, you know, where you can just write something and it goes through a satellite to another place on the planet. And we were in Berlin, and I got two drawings by a fax from the house. One of them was a comparative map of China versus Germany. And the other one said, happy birthday. And it wasn't my birthday, but it turns out that it was my bodyguard's birthday. And I don't know how she could have known that, but he was certainly amazed to see the drawing.
And what about Dweezil, though? I mean, just tell me a little bit more about him. Does he play the same sort of music as you?
Or? No, he plays kind of heavy metal, and he has a contract with Chrysalis. And his new album is called My Guitar Wants to Kill Your Mama.
And how old is he?
He is 18.
So he's sort of out on his own already. You're not sort of a parent to him anymore, is that?
Oh, yeah, certainly, because he still lives at the house.
He still lives at the house.
Yeah.
And what sort of parent are you? What sort of father are you?
Well, I could suggest that you use your imagination, but no, I'm really pretty good.
Are you? Well, I mean, do you have any rules for the children, apart from no drugs in the house, which I know you've always had as a rule?
Well, they have to be in by a certain time, just like other parents would do with their kids, and I suppose it's especially important in Los Angeles for two reasons, because L.A. is a dangerous city, and also because they have a curfew for kids under a certain age, and they have to be in.
Under what age?
I think it's 16, and they can't be out past 11 o'clock, so we have to keep an eye on Amit.
But how can he be a sex fiend, a sex-crazed fiend, in the day when AIDS is so prevalent? I mean, what happens now?
Well, let's describe the situation in the United States. The most recent statistic that I heard is that the main age bracket where people are being discovered with AIDS is 30 and above. There are children who are born to parents who have had it, but there is virtually no AIDS in the teenage category. One of the best-kept secrets in American television. And what's been going on in American television is a constant barrage of advertising about AIDS. Every day on the news you see two or three stories about AIDS. And the whole thrust of it is designed to dissuade teenagers from having sex, when in fact that's one of the lowest risk groups. But the conservative government in the United States thinks that this is a wonderful opportunity to use the fear of catching a fatal disease to keep kids from having a good time. So I don't think that there's much of a risk at all for a person in a 13-year-old age bracket.
What about Moon and Teresa's age?
The danger age starts right at around 30.
You think so, yeah.
Yeah. That was the report that I saw.
You say you're a good father, and so presumably they've got nothing much to rebel against, which is different from your own environment when you grew up.
Yeah, well, one of the things that I do that's different than the way that my parents raised me was if they said no, it meant no, even if it didn't make any sense at all. And in our house, if I say no and any one of the kids disagrees with it and they can logically prove that I'm wrong, they win. Okay, and I think that's a good way to teach kids to use logic and to learn to negotiate. And I think that's something that ought to be developed in homes.
I try to do that myself with Damien. But what do you think about, your parents were very conventional, weren't they? And what was it about your parents, do you think, that made you the way you are?
Not very much. You know, because basically when you get to a point and you see that your parents are behaving in a way that is either illogical or irrelevant, you may not wish to argue with them, or you don't want to hurt them because they have been nice to you and all that, so you just ignore them and you find your own way. Because I think that if I would have followed every rule that was in the house when I grew up, I would be like them, and I wouldn't have had a very good time.
Okay, well, let's play a piece of music now. Let's play Lucille from Joe's Garage.
That's a good idea.
What can you tell me about that one?
That was originally written for the Jeff Simmons album that I produced in about 1969. And that album went nowhere, but I thought it was a good song, so I built it into the storyline of Joe's Garage so that eventually somebody would get to hear the song.
I still love her.